Like, yeah, this crazy dude turns up and he sort of bends over, pulls his pants down, and like a fly squatter spanks him, yes, and stuff. For that time, that was relatively shocking if you're watching Doctor Who.
Muse, my favourite band in the world, and obviously I'm not just saying that because I'm joined by Matt and Dom from the band. How are you doing, guys?
Great. How are you doing,
Tim? I'm all right. I'll level with you, lads. I've just flown in from Gatwick, from America, and I'm a little bit sleepy, but I figured out that I've been basically following you around America.
Oh, wow.
Every place that you went, I seemed to go from St. Louis to Nashville.
You should have come to a show.
I know. Well, it was a week after, weirdly enough. Okay, so it's just weird. I feel like I've been kind of gumshoeing you, so to speak.
What were you doing over there?
Just a little road trip. So, yeah, but cool. I just managed to do pretty much the same place as you. Did you have a good time in the US?
Loved it, yeah. We're still kind of touring there, technically. We've got like a couple of weeks off, but we had a great time there. We're out with 30 Seconds to Mars and Purvis or Paris.
Is it
Purvis?
They're called Paris.
Paris and
still not decided.
And so it's a great bill, you know, and everyone's a bit sort of boozed up and stuff, so it's a great atmosphere. It feels like a festival every night, do you know what I mean? So it's really good crowds.
You witnessed the great St. Louis Arch. I was very impressed with that myself.
Yeah, that's amazing, yeah. We couldn't get up it, though, this time.
You go up in this little lift and it kind of gets smaller and smaller, you know, the higher up the arch you get. And there's a little viewing platform at the top, but it's kind of packed and tiny.
Yeah, so I was trying to figure out how the lift works. Does it go up and then left and then up and then left?
It's like a little train, isn't it? Like a little rail that goes up a hill, like one of those funiculars. I believe that's the correct term.
Yes, the paternosters.
Is that what you call it, a funicular?
You start off standing up and then you get out the lift lying down.
We've all had nights like that.
Testicular.
You did New Orleans as well. Have you done the Bourbon Street mess? That's the first time I'd sort of done that. I mean, have you had a hand grenade drink in your hand and just kind of strolled up and down that street?
We ended up in a... It was like a transvestites bar or something, wasn't it? Like a cross-dressing... What was that bar we ended up in?
That was
like a Moulin
birthday.
Rouge type thing. Yeah, it was my birthday night. Yeah, we ended up drinking all sorts of weird things that night. But
It's cool. The last time I was there, I bought a sword.
An actual sword?
Yeah, like I bought like a French... cavalry sabre.
Interesting conversation at customs. Yeah. So I absolutely adore the new single Dig Down. It's the song we needed lyrically. Dark times. We need something a little bit more hopeful. Can you tell us a little bit about the genesis of the song?
Yeah, that's exactly what it is, really. Yeah, it sounds cheesy saying it, but yeah, it's a message of hope through dark times, through difficult times. You can relate to that both from a personal point of view or from a political point of view if you want. You know, there's only really one verse in there that sort of makes it seem like it could be political.
Yes.
But the rest of it, I'd say, is more of a sort of personal thing. You know, the video, we worked with this amazing actress called Lauren Wasser,
She was incredible.
Yeah, and she's got an amazing story of how she went through this toxic shock syndrome. You know, I think we have this thing inside us sometimes. You don't know until you come to adversity that, you know, that maybe there is some inner strength that you have, and I think we all have it in us, you know, and I think that's what the song's trying to dig down and find. Yeah.
Oh, you all got a bit, little bit Max Headroom.
Yeah, totally. Yeah,
fantastic.
Yeah.
He was a big fixture in my mind back in the day. I don't really remember what his show was about, but I remember him just being around all the time.
Totally, but I love the hack that someone did, you know, that in the 80s on TV, that's what we were sort of influenced by with the video, part of the video. It was in the 80s, someone put on a mask and hacked a network.
That's right, yes.
And it was the first big hack ever. Everyone's watching... It was actually, believe it or not, it was Doctor Who they were watching.
Right.
It was a British reruns of Doctor Who from the 60s on network television in the US.
And somebody managed to get
in. And suddenly, like, yeah, this crazy dude turns up and he sort of bends over, pulls his pants down, and like a fly squatter spanks him and stuff. And it's pretty, you know, I mean, for that time, that was relatively shocking if you're watching Doctor Who. You know, so. What's amazing about that is that person never got found, you know, and it was the biggest hack ever. And it actually changed, the US law changed after that.
Last year, you headlined Glastonbury for a third time. Wow. You've done every day now. Nowadays, festivals run from like Wednesday to Monday. Do you fancy a stint in like a circus tent on a Thursday or something like that?
Cirque du Soleil, that's the next step. I think it'd be great to do a show with them as a collaboration, you know. I think that'd be great.
Yeah, festivals have changed so much since you guys started playing, I think it's fair to say. Have you noticed the kind of difference? I mean, presumably the food's got better, for crying out loud.
Definitely, yeah. You can get a nice vegan burger at most at most festivals nowadays.
I suppose that, what
are you talking about? I don't know why that came out. Food, you're talking about food, that's why. Yeah, nice pulled pork.
Have you guys eaten today?
I'm actually pretty hungry, yeah. That's probably why I'm talking about festival food. The biggest change, I think, is the music has changed massively, hasn't it?
Music's changed, yes. I mean, Glastonbury's always been diverse, but I think more festivals like even Reading now, they're like, which we're playing, It's the music's way more eclectic, way more diverse, which is a great thing.
When we were growing up, it was very sort of tribal. You were either into punk rock or emo or ska, certainly in my town anyway.
Yeah, totally.
Or metal. But now people listen to a bit of metal, they listen to a bit of, you know, Kendrick Lamar and stuff. And
absolutely,
it's
yeah.
not quite so tribal.
Yeah, I think the festivals reflect that. Yeah, I think everyone's listening to all sorts of different genres now, and that tribal element's gone, I think. Yeah.
Lovely moment recently when you saw a busker.
Yeah, that was yesterday. Yeah.
Was that yesterday?
That was last night. Yeah,
was
yeah.
that last night on Instagram? Fresh news from Muse at 10. Very, very underrated busking song. I don't know why I've never heard a busking.
I've never heard anyone busk any of our songs. So I was pretty.
Oh, really?
It was amazing. I was walking across. It was like a romantic date night. You know what I mean? We were going. I was walking across Millennium Bridge, and we were going to see Romeo and Juliet in the Shakespeare's Globe. You know?
Oh, fantastic!
And it's a lovely walk there. You know, across that bridge. And as we were walking across, I literally heard like someone singing "Unintended" in the background. I was like, "That can't be real." You know, that's like a setup. I thought I was about to get spoofed or something. You know, and looked over the edge of the bridge, and there was some geezer down there singing it. It was amazing. Yeah, he was doing a great job. So I went down there and gave him 50 quid and gave him a hug. Yeah,
oh, lovely job.
One pink beast in my pocket, and I thought it was meant to be. You know,
have you ever seen anyone drum solo your one of your songs? I mean, there must be enough people on YouTube doing like tutorials and stuff for you.
Yeah, there's loads of that. I've never seen it in the streets, but I would love to.
I'd
give them 100 quid.
A double up. You're going to be doing Red and Lee, Red, Reading. You're going to be in Red. Have you met Red? Reading and Leeds. You're considering throwing the set list over to the fans. Risky?
I
think you might have tweeted something, and somebody went, "Yeah."
We thought about it. The sort of the Reading audience, you know, they're not all going to be our fans. Do you know what I mean? There's going to be a bunch of people out there that probably don't know us. So we thought to do a sort of by request show that'd be interesting. We thought it'd be good to do a smaller show where it is mainly sort of our fan base. You know what I mean? So we might do. I think we're going to do a. We're thinking of doing like a charity show, basically of some kind, in London, like kind of a warm up gig before Reading, and we'll definitely do that one to be like by request. Because if it's like such a couple thousand people, then I think it will be like they're going to pick really interesting stuff.
Yes.
You know? Whereas if it's like 60,000 people, like, you know, half those people will go like, "What Muse? Who are they? Like, what Uprising maybe or something?" You know what I mean? Like, we'll probably end up with just like a relatively safe set list. You know what I mean?
Do you kind of find yourself when people do request songs that you've not played in a little while? Do you have to go back and sort of relearn the chords and relearn the riffs and stuff like that?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean,
God, yes.
Yeah. It takes a few goes, you know, before it comes back. It's all in there somewhere. It's bizarre. Yeah. It's bizarre how it comes back. But yeah, it definitely takes a few goes. Funnily enough, just before this, we were just listening to a couple of old tracks, and you mentioned some song that I just had no idea how it went from the title until I listened to it, and it's like, wow, Jesus.
Yeah, some of the old ones, I do actually have to listen to them and like relearn them, to be honest. Yeah, my muscle memory is pretty loose. Yeah, pretty bad, I'd say, yeah.
You ever go online and get like the online guitar archives and just, you know, the old Olga and get them back down again?
Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to remember what it was. There was some guitar lick or something of a song that we haven't played for a long time. I had to like look it up. I had to go on like on YouTube,
like a YouTube tutorial,
and see some kid playing it and go like, "Oh, that's it. I remember it now." Okay. Yeah.
You didn't even leave a comment. Yeah. Thanks, Matt Mellamy. Guys, thank you so much for joining us. We really look forward to seeing you guys at Red and Leeds, and I'm sure we'll speak to you again.
Cool. Thanks a lot.
Look forward to the new music.